It's very important to the process of understanding Google Cloud and passing the certification exam that you go through the question and attempt answering it yourself first. So pause the video, work through the question. We'll catch up in just a little while and I'll show you how I do it. This project scenario is based on the TerramEarth case study. Ideally, you should have gone through the case study and figured out some of the key points about this business requirement. Even otherwise, it is possible to answer some of these questions with a fair amount of just common sense and applying what you see in the question itself. In this requirement, the TerramEarth team finds out that it's got a large amount of data, but it doesn't exactly know how to deal with it right now. So they want to build a system that captures and stores all raw data in case they need it later. How can we most cost-effectively accomplish this goal? The key parts of the question are, one, we do not know every possible future use case for the data, so we just capture and store everything irrespective of whether we are immediately using it or not. We also want to accomplish this without incurring a huge cost. How do we go about this? Now, this requirement that we capture and store all the raw data is a concept called the data lake. In comparison to what used to be a data warehouse, a data lake is different primarily in the kind of data that it stores. A data warehouse typically stores structured data. So when you have data coming in, if they fit a particular schema that has been predefined, then it's easy to load that into the data warehouse. So this data now is also instantly ready for analysis. Whereas in the case of a data lake, there is no structure to the data. You have not yet defined a schema that defines the key parts of the data. Instead, what you want to do is you want to store all the data in whatever was its raw form. So if you got, say, images or videos, this is not structured data. So it can't go into a typical data warehouse, whereas it easily goes into a data lake. Even when you get structured data, say as comma-separated values, CSV files or Avro files or Parquet files, this could be stored in a file format in the data lake for later analysis. So the key idea in the data lake is that we turn away nothing. Whatever data we get, we want to be able to store it. So our data lake solution has to have the ability to store all kinds of data. Since we are storing all kinds of data, it also needs to scale to a large capacity. We shouldn't have to do additional hard disk provisioning to increase the capacity, and it should just have almost limitless capacity. When you're storing so much data, we obviously don't want to incur a large cost, so ideally, such storage should be inexpensive, right? We don't want to incur a very high cost. Even though we're storing a large amount of data, we want to be able to retrieve and process it quickly. So it should not be that this data, which say typically doesn't fit on regular hard disks, we can't take it to a tape drive, because then putting the tape drive somewhere in a machine, having the spin and then reading the data is a lot of time. So that is not ideal for the kind of data analysis that we do today. Say for example, if you're doing machine learning, we don't want to go through this process of taking up the tape from from another place, plugging it in, and then retrieving all the data. We want data to be immediately available as soon as we want it. Yet, we still want to have archival capabilities. A lot of the data might not be used, and we have a fair estimate that this much data has been used and will be used, whereas something, say, beyond 5 years or 10 years, for certain business cases, might be archived. It's better archived just so that we can reduce some costs. So a data-like solution should ideally have archival capabilities. We also want to be able to restrict the permissions available to users to access certain kinds of data. So Certain users might want access to some data and certain other users should not be allowed to access that. So we have to have a way in which we can set granular access permissions to specific groups of users or individual users. Having understood all that about the data lake, let us look at option A. Option A suggests that we stream the data directly into BigQuery. This flowchart should be very familiar to you. If you have not gone through the associate cloud engineer videos, please go through them. They set a good base for all the things that we'll be doing hereafter. So looking at the storage choices, we have that under structured and SQL data is where BigQuery resides. So to work with BigQuery, ideally your data is structured or at least semi-structured. However, our data that we are getting in this case could be any kind of data. It could be JSON formats, it could be files, it could be images, it could be videos. We don't exactly know what is the kind of data coming in. Therefore, BigQuery as an option is not suitable because BigQuery requires the data to be structured. How about the option B that we first pass the data to Cloud PubSub, which is a great option to scale, and then we dump that into a Cloud Dataproc cluster that stores the data in Apache Hadoop, which is on persistent disks. Well, why sub-pub-sub to data proc to HDFS? It just seems like too many steps, right? It just seems a little overcomplicated and over-engineering. So even if this worked, this might not be a cost-effective solution because we are going to have to maintain all these different parts. Ideally, we should be looking for something a little more simpler to work with. Next, why data proc? Data proc is ideally used for processing. You're going to be setting up VMs with compute power. But we're not processing anything. We just want to capture and store. So data proc is not going to be cost effective because we're going to be having a whole bunch of clusters with VMs, and that is not suitable for our requirement here. In addition to that, HDFS here is on persistent disks, and it means that we will have to provision these hard disks. And when we have to provision the hard disk, we will have to also care about scaling it manually. So overall, this doesn't seem to be a reasonable solution because it's not cost effective and it is complicated. How about option C? In option C, we continue to dump the data via FTP. Then we adjust the existing Linux machines and use a collector to upload them into Dataproc HDFS for storage. This is fairly fun, right? We have already used dumping the data via FTP in case of TerramEarth. Can we adjust the existing Linux machines to find out when the file has been received and then do something at that point? The answer is yes. Linux, for example, has a library called iNotify and a tool called iNotify tool, which allows you to watch for file changes, and when the file change happens, you can take some action based on it. So the first two parts of it are reasonably fine. However, the third part comes back to HDFS storage and Cloud Data Proc, which we already discovered is unnecessarily roundabout. We also don't need Data Proc for processing because we only need storage, and the hard disk for this have to be managed by us. This is not a suitable solution. So C is eliminated. How about the option D, which suggests that we have the vehicles in the field continue to dump data by FTP and adjust the existing Linux machines to immediately upload it to cloud storage with GSUtil. We already discussed that dumping the data by FTP and adjusting the existing Linux machines to pick up newly uploaded files is possible. How about third part of the option, that we upload it to cloud storage with GSUtil? Looking at our storage diagram, we can see that when the data is unstructured files, we've got a couple of options, cloud storage and cloud file store. Within that, cloud file store is not a great option because we have to again manage some part of the hard disk. And it is going to be attached to the compute, which is not exactly what we want, because then scaling becomes an issue. So we can eliminate Cloud Firestore, and we are left with cloud storage as the option. Now that we have cloud storage, we know that GSUtil is the utility that works with cloud storage that allows you to transfer files and retrieve files from cloud storage. Given that, we now have the final answer that D would work for us, while we can easily eliminate options A, B, and C. All right, now it's time for you to like, share, comment, and subscribe. Go ahead, do that right now, because there's loads of great content coming up for learning Google Cloud and preparing for the certifications.